मॉर्निंग मैडम।
गुड मॉर्निंग सर। मैम शैल वी स्टार्ट मैम?
यस मैम।
गुड मॉर्निंग वन एंड ऑल प्रेजेंट हियर ऑन बिहाफ ऑफ डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ जुआलॉजी डीकेएम कॉलेज वेल्लूर। आई वेलकम यू ऑल फॉर वन डे नेशनल लेवल वेबिनार ऑन इमर्जिंग ट्रेंड्स इन जुआलॉजी। फर्स्ट आई वुड लाइक टू कॉल अपॉन आवर एचओडी मैम डॉक्टर डी शशिकला टू इंट्रोड्यूस द वेबिनार टॉपिक एंड वेलकम द गैदरिंग।
Working Krishna Swami in the college for women. The general
Dhanabhagyam Krishna Swami Mudaliar College for Women is a general degree college located in Vellore, Tamil Nadu. It is the first college established in the year 1972, the then Narthakad district of Tamil Nadu, for the empowerment of women by the single personality Vellore Vallal Thiru N. Krishnaswamy Mudaliar in the name of his wife Dhanabhagyam Ammal. With their blessings, our college is marching towards its 50th year. On occasion of this Golden Jubilee celebration, we are conducting this one-day national-level webinar on emerging trends in biosciences. I take this opportunity as a privilege in welcoming our today's chief guest, Dr. Yogalakshmi from the Department of Environmental Science and Technology, Central University of Punjab, and Dr. Jasmine M. Shaw from the Department of Plant Science, Central University of Kerala. Welcome you, both of you, ma'am. I would like to extend a warm welcome to our Secretary, sir, Thirudi Maninathan, sir, and our President, Dr. T. Shivakumar, sir, and our Principal, Dr. P. N. Sudha, ma'am, for this wonderful occasion. It's my pleasure to welcome all our department faculties from the DKMC family and faculties from various colleges and my dear student participants to this national seminar. I welcome once again one and all for this seminar. Enjoy and make use of this program. Thanks to the Almighty and our founder. Now I call upon our principal ma'am for felicitating this program.
Yes. Thank you, Dr. Shashikala. Good morning, everyone. Dr. Yogalakshmi and Dr. Jasmine in particular, I welcome you for this national webinar on emerging trends in biosciences. We are conducting this as a part of our Golden Jubilee year celebrations, and this is being organized by the Department of Zoology. On behalf of DKM College, on behalf of the management, on my own behalf, I congratulate the Department of Zoology for taking efforts in conducting this webinar and for inviting two eminent personalities, two women, for this seminar. And the topics also are found to be very interesting. Dr. Yogalakshmi is going to talk on solid waste management, which is the need for the hour, how to manage the waste. That is the great problem the humankind is facing. So various techniques people are adopting, but nothing is 100% perfect. So we're expecting new technologies and new ideas for the management of solid waste from Dr. Yogalakshmi. And also Dr. Jasmine is going to talk on epigenetic regulation and transgenerational memory in plants. And this transgenerational memory is not only in plants, but it's also in human, also in animals. Again, it is a very interesting topic, which will be an eye-opener for our students and also our staff members who are willing to do some research on this area. I once again thank the Department of Zoology for taking initiative to conduct this webinar. I also congratulate the student participants for their presence and I request them to make full use of this webinar. I welcome both the speakers. Thank you once again.
Thank you, ma'am, for your encouraging and motivating speech. Now I would like to call Dr. A. Vinodini to introduce the first resource person.
Vinodini, it is not audible.
Vinod.
You can unmute. Yes. No, not it.
Vinod, inge vandrunga illena. Sir, good morning, sir. Sir, good morning. Sir, welcome, sir. Yes, ma'am. லைவ் ஸ்ட்ரீமிங்ல பார்க்கல போயின் இருக்கா ஹலோ ஆ சொல்லுமா ஆ இப்போ நான் அனுப்புறமா ஓகே ஓகே வினோ வினோ ஃபீட்பேக் லிங்க் மட்டும் ஃபீட்பேக் லிங்க்குங்க மேம் காப்பி பண்ணி வினோ போஸ்ட் பண்ண சொல்லிடுறேன் ஏன்னா இதில் என்ன பண்ணாலும் அது லைவ் ஸ்ட்ரீம் ஆகுது நல்லா வந்துருச்சுல பரவாயில்ல பார்ட்டிசிபென்ட்ஸ் கூட 93 சொல்லவே நீங்க பேசுறதெல்லாம் அதை ரெக்கார்ட் ஆகுது
It's mostly CG methylation. So, repeats of CG, CG, CG are prone to methylation. But in plants, apart from CG, we also have CHH and CHG methylation. So, H can be any base except G. So, that way, little bit of plants are more dependent on epigenetic regulation than animals. So maybe because plants are sessile organisms, they can't run away from a situation. They have to face the stress, and even they can't speak like what animals do. Their vocabulary is not there. So maybe for all these reasons, plants have no other choice but to adapt to various conditions, isn't it? So in that way, plants are more dependent on epigenetic regulation in compared to other the animal counterparts. So now epigenetic regulation is something like, as I told you, part of gene regulation, but more importantly, what makes this regulation more interesting is that it's not just a regulation at a particular time of development or stress or growth or whatever, but it is also inherited. So it has the potential to be inherited. That is what makes this epigenetics really interesting study. So that's why it's like parallel to genetics. So we all know genetics is a study of heredity and variation, and epigenetics also, we can tell it is also a study of heredity and variation, because though here we do not talk about change in the DNA sequence, there is nothing called gene or but still there is some variation happening, and it has the potential to be heritable. So not all epigenetic changes are heritable, but epigenetic changes have the potential to be heritable. It depends on situation, on many situations. And why this is inherited? So the reason is these changes are faithfully taken over or passed over after DNA replication. So we all know that whether it is mitosis or meiosis, presiding to these two divisions, we always have a S phase in the cell, right? The cell cycle S phase is where the DNA actually replicates. So after a particular S phase, the DNA content will be double than what it was. So instead of 2N, it becomes 4N after S phase. So at that time, like when the DNA replicates, if there is a methyl group present on the parental strand, okay, so during replication, what happens is that when the daughter strand, like the newly synthesized daughter strand, though may not have the methyl group attached to its cytosine, but very eventually this it is the recognized that the parent is having a methyl group, and soon the methyl group is added to the daughter strand. So here we can see there is no methyl group in the parent. As a consequence, there is no group in the daughter also. But here we have methyl group in the parent, and see, initially it doesn't have in the daughter, but soon it the methyl group is added to the daughter strand. So this thing is faithfully transferred after DNA replication and is maintained during mitosis as well as meiosis. So that is what makes it heritable. Now, so there are reports, recent reports that, having this methyl group can play a dual role. It can either enhance transcription or reduce transcription, and they also play a crucial role by interacting with transcription factors. So together, like gene regulation is involving transcription factor as well as these methylation changes in the regulatory regions, and they, as a consequence, they affect the transcription, that is the binding of RNA polymerase and onto the promoter and regulatory regions are affected because of these interactions. Now, so as I like any gene regulation, this epigenetic regulation also is a part of the routine development. Plus, I told you it plays a very important role in adaptation, especially in plants. Now, these plants, they like all organisms are subjected to biotic and abiotic stresses. Yes. Including like now we are having this pandemic thing, COVID-19 going on. So we humans are also under biotic stress, right? But plants, they don't have a choice, right? They have to face the stress. They cannot escape from the stress. And these stresses, the plants have to adapt to these stresses. And that's where epigenetic regulation plays a crucial role. So generally, when plants face stress, there is a cascade of reactions taking place, like change in the osmotic stress and disruption of the ionic homeostasis and signal transduction, involvement of kinases, transcription factors, and so on, which finally leads to activation and inactivation of genes for, required to face the stress condition. Now, can plants remember the stress? So this is where we have the epigenetic regulation playing a crucial role. That is, like animals, plants don't have a brain. They don't have a nervous system. They don't have a brain. But still, they can remember conditions of stress, and the memory can be stored for a longer time, even up to the progeny. So this is here, we have an example. I'm sure many of you must have noticed. So if we are keeping the plant, always pampered by watering, when it gets exposed to a small situation of dehydration or drought, it cannot withstand that shock and it will wilt off easily. But if we are giving intermittent shock of a little bit of drought and sunlight and all that, regularly if the plants are given a harsh conditions, they can actually survive well. I'm sure many of you must be involved in gardening activities in your home, or even rule holds true for even when we want to raise our children, isn't it? We don't want to pamper them too much that they can't face the stress. So this is true for the plants also. And in fact, I also came across a recent WhatsApp message where they convey like two neighbors have a garden, and one fellow used to water his plants very regularly, pampered, and the other guy was not pampering his plants. But when the storm condition, when there was a storm, sudden storm in their place, the person whose plants were not pampered, you know, they survived. But the other guy, even though like he was watering the plants every day regularly, and too much of watering, his plants could not survive the harsh conditions. So this adaptation is very crucial for all organisms, and this kind of adaptation actually involves epigenetic regulation. So in plants, these kind of stresses, they induce memory in such a way that the plants are primed in the sense they are made ready to face harsh conditions for a later stage. So at a young stage, if they face harsh conditions, later this memory is retained throughout the life of the plant. So that is called as priming. And some of these memory can even go to subsequent generation. That's called as transgenerational memory. And this kind of memory is present in plants as well as animal system. And the basis for this memory is epigenetic regulation. We will come to the details. And here we have example of where heat stress on Arabidopsis thaliana plant, it increased fitness. So Arabidopsis thaliana is a model organism. Like for animal system, we have mouse, Drosophila model system. Same way in plants, we have the Arabidopsis thaliana model system. So it was found that when these plants are subjected to heat stress, so these plants, they cannot actually tolerate heat conditions. They are grown in a temperature of 22 to 24 degree Celsius and not at higher temperatures. So they're very sensitive. But if we give small heat shocks, so it not only increases the fitness, but the progeny and the grand progeny of the plant was shown to have increased fitness. So these kind of experiments are not done on one individual or two individuals. It's done on a population, and the overall response of the population is assayed. So this was one of the initial observations of memory in plants. And there were also reports of herbivory on brassica mustard plant, which again increased plant growth and reproduction. And this kind of a change in phenotype was observed in for subsequent generations. So based on such, there were many other reports based on such reports. So now the question comes, like why is there a stress induced memory on the plant? So we all know that any stress, say for example UV radiation and all, are they are very gamma radiation are classical examples of stress induced changes, mutagenic changes in all organisms, isn't it? So we need not go to a very harsh stress like UV or gamma or any mutagen, but any stress for that matter, any stress as simple as a heat or a drought or a disease condition can cause change in the genome, isn't it? Now, these changes are mostly, we can classify them as mutagenic, or the changes involved taking place in the genetic material. and of lately the epigenetic changes. So these interplay of these two changes is what causes the changes in the phenotype of the organism, because of which they can survive better in unfavorable conditions, isn't it? So it's all about survival, adaptation, and the reason for that is somewhere there. So the like we know that mutagenic changes are not reversible. So once a mutation has happened, it's permanent. But epigenetic change, they are reversible. They can always go back to the original version. So that is one of the major differences when we compare the epigenetic change and the mutagenic changes. So here there is a small comparison. We have comparison of the top panel has mutation shown on the chromosome. And in the next generation, the mutation is maintained. And even after the nth generation, n is any number. After any generation, if you see that mutation is retained in the chromosome. But when it comes to epimutations, epimutation has happened, it can retain in the nth generation, or it can reduce, or it can completely disappear. So that is the difference between epimutation and mutation, where mutation is very steady, firm, and epimutation is kind of flexible, reversible, and so on. So this is just a brief picture depicting the final effect of mutation and epimutation comparison. So here we have denotes nothing, but we can call it as a protein molecule or anything, something which in which a gene would convey itself into. So generally a gene undergoes transcription to give rise to a protein. So when a mutation is involved, you know, the final product keeps on changing. So this arrows depict generation. So after subsequent generations, the final version may not at all be like an original version. But look at the epimutation part. So here changes may give rise to newer versions, and in middle, it can even go back to the original one. So it is very highly dynamic. Epimutations are highly dynamic and reversible. So if we put it in graphical way, like here we have orange line is genetic changes or mutations, and the blue line is epigenetic changes. So we can see genetic changes, they keep on accumulating over generations. They keep on increasing and adding to it. But epigenetic changes, you know, they increase or decrease depending on the stress. So more the stress, more epigenetic changes, and again when the stress is removed, it can revert back, and so on. So that is the simple comparison between the epigenetic changes and genetic changes. So now stress induced, like I had previously shown you, stress had increased fitness in plants, isn't it? Now there were reports that stresses, in fact, they caused loci specific changes in organisms. So certain gene loci were found to be altered, in the sense altered epigenetically, in the plants which underwent stresses. And the reports also showed people used reporter genes to show that UV radiation and temperature had induced altered loci specific changes in plants. Not only in plants, there are such reports in animals also. There was a report where the survival plants after the Chernobyl accident, so 18 years after the accident, when the geographical location was surveyed, it was found that the plants in these locations survived really well. They survived the nuclear contaminants better than animals. So animals, they always escaped from the region. So they had the choice, but plants did not have the choice, yet they survived really well. And the pine trees and the native Arabidopsis plant, not the lab ones, but the ones which were occurring in wild in these original conditions, were found to have enhanced fitness. And in fact, the studies on these plants showed that they were able to tolerate higher concentrations of other mutagens like rose bengal, methyl methane sulfonate, and so on. And they had higher global genome methylation and enhanced homologous recombination rates. And they had altered gene expression for DNA repair genes involved in facing various mutagenic conditions. So these kind of surveys revealed that there was something different happening in plants which were under stress. So these are some of the examples of somatic and transgenerational memory of stress. So somatic means the one which is existing only within the same generation. So it may last up to a few hours, a few days, a few months. And transgenerational is the one which goes to the progeny and grand progeny. But again, here we have this terminology called as intergenerational. So this is for a few days, for example. And we have here intergenerational and the transgenerational. So why these two kind of terminology? I will come to that slide subsequently. That's because of the comparison between the animal counterparts. I will come to it. So what I want to tell is there are many examples of DNA or histone-associated epigenetic changes under various stresses which have lasted for a long time in plants. So, here's the example of epigenetic changes retained in Alternandra even after 10 asexual generations. So, even after 10 generations, certain memory can be retained. And there are many other examples. So, So what I want to tell is, apart from these stress-induced changes, epigenetic regulation also plays some role in routine maintenance of the plants. So, for example, having an altered phenotype in organisms, it may be beneficial to them or may not be, but it may not be due to a new gene or a new allele. It could also be due to epi alleles or epi mutations. For example, here this in tomato we can see this altered phenotype in the texture of the fruit, and that is because of these altered methylation on the promoter region of the gene. So we can see here these the dark boxes indicates methylation, and those methyl groups are absent in the wild type sequence. So the genomic sequence is same, but the presence and absence of methyl groups decide the phenotype of the organism. Here we have another example the Darwin's finches. So this particular bird, like there are different genus of birds across the world which come under the category which are popularly known as Darwin's finches. And when the total genome sequencing was done for these birds, the genome sequencing and epigenome sequencing, it was interesting to find that some closely related species, for example, we have these two species, Geopsita fortis and fuliginosa. These two species actually, they show more variation due to their epigenetic changes than the genetic changes. So so here 84 and 34 means 84 is for epi mutations and 34 is for the mutations or changes in the DNA. So such studies, elaborate studies are occurring these days, which indicate that like how mutations play an important role in species, speciation and survival of organisms. Epimutations are also playing equally important role in generating or demarcating different species due to the geographical stresses or whatever. Whatever may be the condition, but yeah, the when we do a very elaborate study, we can feel, we can get to know that it's not just the genetic sequence that matters, but also the epigenetic changes in the organism that plays a crucial role. Yeah, coming the when we compare this animal system and plant system. So I had told you about this terminology intergenerational and transgenerational, isn't it? So the difference is that, like in animal system, for example, if an organism is undergoing some stress, so if there are some stress-induced epimutations taking place in the organism, now these changes, these epimutations could occur either in the somatic cells or germline cells, isn't it? We know that in animals, the germline cells is predetermined. So when an organism is undergoing a stress, actually it's not just that organism, but also the gametes that it is carrying, whether it is male or female, the cells are already present in the germline, and these also undergo stress. As a consequence, whatever phenotypic change we see in the progeny, okay, in the progeny of these animals, maybe because the gametes actually, you know, had the memory retained in them, or maybe it's because of the stress that the gamete, the cells underwent. So we cannot call it as a true memory, because the gametes were already present in the parent. So that is why this terminology intergenerational and transgenerational is important in animal system, because in animal system, whatever we see in the first progeny, the child may be called as an intergenerational memory, and if the memory is going to the second generation or subsequent generation, it is called as transgenerational memory. So, but in case of plants, it may not be the case, because in plants, we know that the reproductive system actually comes, is generated from the somatic cells. So when a somatic cell